Welcome to Ring of Fire, I'm Farron Cousins, and here's what's happening tonight. Believe it or not, there was a time in American politics when the agenda of Congress was not dictated by corporations and the wealthy elite. And we'll explain how we got to this point and where we're headed if we stay on this path. We're less than 1 week away from the Iowa caucus, so we'll see how each party stacks up before the first real contest in this presidential race. And the U.S. is marching right back into another Middle Eastern conflict. We'll bring you the details in tonight's backstory. That's what's coming up. You've just stepped in to the Ring of Fire.
There's been zero warming, none whatsoever.
I'm running for president of the United States.
Congress declares war, not the president. Start with the countries that are burning our flag.
We regret these errors and apologize.
We apologize.
We apologize.
And apologize.
This is good news, people.
In less than 1 week, we'll know which candidates from both sides have won the Iowa caucus, and as we inch closer to that day, candidates from both parties are scrambling to make their cases before voters head to the polls. Now let's first look at what's happening on the Republican side. A week out from Iowa, and Donald Trump is still in the lead with Ted Cruz in a distant second. This comes as no surprise to anyone who's looked at the polls in the last 2 months. But it isn't what the Republican establishment wanted to see a week before the first caucus. Like most of us, the Republican establishment never imagined that Donald Trump would make it this far in his campaign. They had assumed that Jeb Bush would probably be the front runner and that the race would basically be over before voters in Iowa even made it to the polls. But as we've explained in the past, the establishment grossly underestimated their own base. A base that they lost touch with when the Tea Party burst onto the scene with the help of the Koch brothers. At that moment, the focus of Republican voters shifted away from traditional conservative issues, things like abortion, religion, and guns, and onto non-issues and divisive hate. Now, obviously, those other issues are still major talking points for Republican candidates, but the real driving force behind this new Republican base is hate. Hatred of anyone and anything that is non-white and non-male. The establishment somehow managed to ignore what was happening to their own party, and as a result, they ended up with Donald Trump as their frontrunner. And that's why, with only 1 week left before the first round of caucus voting, conservative establishment groups are taking one last shot at taking Trump down for good. The National Review released an editorial late last week that essentially begged conservatives to abandon the Donald Trump bandwagon because, according to the paper, he isn't a real conservative. Now, they make the case that Trump lacks civility and that he has absolutely no knowledge of policy and that he's too arrogant and self-centered to care about the Republican Party itself. Now, look, all of these claims are absolutely true, but they can also be said of every single person running for president under the Republican banner. They apply to almost every conservative currently holding office in Washington, D.C. And that's because a lack of civility, a lack of policy knowledge, and an abundance of arrogance have all become Republican Party ideals in the last decade. Is Donald Trump threatened at all by this establishment? Absolutely not. And we know that because of the statement that he made last week where he told crowds that he could probably shoot someone in broad daylight for no reason, and he wouldn't lose a single supporter. And again, he's absolutely correct about that. That's because anyone who's so devoid of intellect that they would support Donald Trump, they're not going to be fazed by anything that he does. It was the same thing that we saw play out during the George W. Bush years. No matter what that man did as president, his supporters would blindly follow and defend every one of his actions. And that's what the Republican Party has become today. A spineless, terrified group of yes-men who desperately crave an authoritarian leader who promises to keep them safe. And again, this all goes back to the creation of the Tea Party, as well as the Supreme Court's decision to allow corporations to buy our elections. Conservative, and even some Democratic politicians, they no longer care about their party or their party's goals. They only care about winning that next election. And they can only do that if they have the corporate money, which they can only get if they're willing to do everything corporations ask of them. So the National Review can attack Donald Trump all that they want, but it seems like their problem has more to do with what they've turned the party into at this point. Over on the Democratic side, things are slightly more civil, but no less chaotic. Both Hillary Clinton and Bernie Sanders have been debating whether or not the Vermont senator's single-payer health care plan is even possible. And the answer is that yes, it certainly is, but that seems to be the lowest thing on the list for the Democratic candidates at the moment. The problem that Hillary Clinton has at the moment is that all of her problems from the past 6 months have come back, some of which because they were never properly handled by Clinton in the first place. For example, her speaking fees from Wall Street banks have become a very serious thorn in her side when Sanders brought them up during the last Democratic debate, and now major news outlets are beginning to ask questions about her ties to Wall Street. As one former Wall Street executive pointed out, the banks are giving her money both directly to her campaign and for her speeches because they want an ally in the White House. They want someone that they know they can depend on to keep things moving in the same direction. And that direction is towards fewer regulations and zero accountability when these banks break the law. Hillary has responded to requests for the transcripts of her Wall Street speeches by trying to laugh the issue off. She believes that downplaying the significance of these speeches is going to have the effect of convincing the public that it isn't a big deal and hopefully they're just going to move on. But that doesn't seem to be happening, as the issue is becoming more and more of a headache for Hillary Clinton. Now, another issue that she has to face are her ties to military defense contractors. It's no secret that Hillary is certainly the most hawkish Democrat running for president now that Jim Webb is out, but that hawkishness becomes a little less palatable when you take a look at her foreign policy advisors and allies and learn that half of them are directly from the defense industry. Now, this is going to remind voters of what happened the last time we had a war-hungry president with a cozy relationship with contractors, and no one wants a repeat of the Bush administration. And then there are the polls showing Bernie Sanders surging ahead, not just in Iowa, but in New Hampshire as well. Hillary's campaign sees all of these things happening, but they either don't know how to respond to it all, or they view it as something else that's just going to pass and that it's not worthy of addressing. Now, having said all that, let's look at another important issue with the Iowa caucus. Specifically, does it even matter? Every candidate is hoping to leave Iowa with the Iowa bounce, which is a wave of support that victors typically experience after coming in first during that caucus. But in recent years, that bounce has not carried the winner of Iowa to the White House. For example, in the 2012 Republican caucus, Rick Santorum won Iowa. In 2008, Mike Huckabee won for the Republicans, and in 2004, Dick Gephardt took the title for the Democrats, only to later drop out when it became clear that John Kerry was the favorite. So for everyone looking at Iowa as some kind of crystal ball that's going to predict the future, it looks like you're going to have to wait a few more months before we get a clear picture of which candidate from either side is going to end up being the nominee. And I know that if you support the candidate that ultimately wins next week, you're going to want to take a victory lap. But you need to keep in mind that Iowa is basically the preseason, not the playoffs. Winning that first contest is a decent accomplishment and could give the winners a small bump in the polls. But as we have seen from past experience, that bump is not always enough to sustain a candidate through the rest of the campaign season. The best that we can hope for with the Iowa outcome is that it narrows the field a little bit. Perhaps we'll see enough Republicans drop out that we won't have to continue having two separate debate stages every time these clowns gather together. Beyond that, I really don't see any reason to put too much stock into the outcome of the Iowa caucus. In more disturbing news, according to Secretary of Defense Ash Carter, the United States has made the decision to send the 101st Airborne Division to the Middle East to help in the ground fight against ISIS. Now, this move comes just 2 months after President Obama adamantly declared that the United States would not get involved in a ground war against ISIS. While U.S. troops have remained in Iraq for years, this is the first time that they are being deployed with the expressed purpose of fighting against the Islamic State terrorists. Now, this idea is a disaster for two reasons. The first is that this is exactly what ISIS wanted the U.S. to do. It was part of their plan from the start. See, they want U.S. troops to go into the Middle East in order to drum up more fear and hatred towards the U.S. from people in the area. Now, this is only going to help bolster the ranks of ISIS as more resentment to the U.S. manifests. Now, we saw the exact same scenario play out with Al-Qaeda during the Iraq War, and this move by the U.S. military will have the exact same effect, and ISIS knows this. Now, the second reason this plan is a disaster is because they're ramping up another unwinnable battle during an election year, and this could cost the Democratic Party dearly. If the situation in the Middle East escalates further due to the U.S. occupation, it's going to give conservatives the ability to say that Democratic leadership has failed on foreign policy and that it's time to shift leadership. And while that would be an even bigger disaster, it's going to undoubtedly drive more conservatives to the polls this year, and that will end very badly for the Democrats. But the biggest thing that everyone seems to miss about the fight against ISIS is that you can't fight a belief system, and that's what ISIS is. Let's put it in perspective this way. Imagine if the U.S. military decided to declare war on the KKK in order to get rid of racism. Now, they could round up every member, drop bombs, or blow up their offices, but it's not going to destroy the racist mentality that the group was founded on. And as time passes, it's simply going to come back in a different form. And that's what ISIS is. It's not a country or a structured organization. It's a set of beliefs. And no, I'm not talking about religious beliefs at all. Religion has nothing to do with this. But that anti-Western, anti-progress, the ideas of that group, they can't be bombed out of existence. They have to be dealt with on a social and ideological level, not on a battlefield. And that's something that the United States refuses to acknowledge. So instead, we play into their game, and regardless of the military outcome here, they have already won. And finally today, I'm sure by now everyone has seen the story about how Sarah Palin is blaming President Obama for her son beating up his girlfriend. Her reasoning is that her son developed PTSD after serving in the military in Iraq. But here's what Sarah Palin left out of her little tirade. Her son, Trax's service tour actually began under the Bush administration, not the Obama administration. Second, her son was heavily intoxicated and was waving around a gun before hurting his girlfriend. And third, it has actually been the Republican Party, not the Democrats or President Obama, who have repeatedly voted against providing more VA funding to treat PTSD and other combat-related injuries. But according to Sarah, this is all Obama's fault. Obama somehow got into her son's head and made him believe that it was okay to hit a woman while you were drinking and holding a gun. No, Sarah, the only people who can put that thought into a child's head are the child's parents. You need to own up to the fact that you're just a bad parent. It's as simple as that. Besides, as Amanda Marcotti pointed out on Salon.com, aren't Republicans the party of personal responsibility? Don't they always tell us that a person's success or failure is 100% dependent on that person's actions? Or does that only apply to people on welfare or people receiving unemployment benefits? Sarah Palin's failures as a parent and the failures of her children have been on public display for the last 7.5 years. And no one is surprised to hear her say something so insane, but the trouble is that she actually believes what she's saying. And that's the scariest part. It's no secret that our democracy today is owned by large corporations and the wealthy elite. And for most Americans coming of age today, this is simply how things have always been. But rest assured, this is not how the government has always been run, and I have Howard Nations with me now to explain how we got to this point. Howard, you and I specifically have discussed the issue of how, you know, the 1% rules, they have just this unlimited influence over our democracy, over our courts. But I think what's important to point out to people is that it wasn't always like this, and that this didn't just suddenly spring up with the Roberts Court here. This is something that they had been working on for close to about 45 years by the time the Supreme Court finally got their hands on it. So take us back a bit and just kind of explain how we even got to this point of where we are today with unlimited corporate rule.
Well, an obvious starting point for the current situation begins with the trickle-down economics of Ronald Reagan in 1980, which began the income inequality shift. When you get enough income inequality, eventually you get to wealth inequality. Wealth inequality came on big time during the years of 2000 to 2008, when Bush and Cheney turned over the keys to the American Treasury to Wall Street and to hedge funds. So since then, we've seen implementation of all kind of policies that led to just extraordinary wealth income, which increases every day. Now, the obvious thing to follow that is, after income and wealth, is to use all that to get a power shift. So now you get the power that goes with all that income and all that wealth. And right now they're trying to accomplish a major power shift in America with a tax on American values. The things that the corporations and the 1% and the Republican leadership fear, they fear voters, they fear jurors, they fear unions. And so they want to use all of this money now to bring about new restrictions on voting, undermining unions and collective bargaining, and the 1% are just straight up buying elections in order to silence the majority. Also, incidentally, they're making a tax on trial by jury, which is another of our most important values that's under siege right now. And they're doing those attacks on multiple fronts. They went to the state legislatures. They're spending vast amounts of money on little, comparatively insignificant state legislative seats, that they're spending massive amounts of money to gain control of state legislatures. They've gone to Congress, where they've been spreading money around forever, and it's having its effect. They also go to the federal agencies that are controlled by Congress, whose purse strings are controlled by Congress. And then, of course, they go to the Roberts Court, which is the Roberts Court is the right wing of the Republican Party. It's the private court of the right wing. And so their goal is a systematic power shift from the majority of Americans to the rich and the super rich minority. And it's working.
Well, and you know what's very interesting about this whole concept here is that Democrats tend to kind of focus on a single issue for the most part. I know we say Republicans are single issue voters, but you have different portions of the Democratic Party, Democratic supporters, who say we are, you know, 100% about the environment. We are 100% about reproductive rights. We're 100% about whatever. And those things are great. You have to have all those, and they're very important issues that are being attacked right now. But what the Republicans did was they set up this multifaceted program to attack every single aspect of American democracy in order to achieve the one goal. And that was, you know, unlimited rule by corporations and the 1%. And as you pointed out, you start off, you go after the workers. You take away their right to unionize, which decreases their income, decreases their power, decreases the amount of money they can give to politicians. You go after, you know, local races, state legislatures, state judges, something we've discussed in the past as well. The money flowing into the lower courts is absolutely unbelievable right now, and it's so that you can kill lawsuits before they begin. Yep. And then, you know, finally from that is they go and they buy the major politicians, the guys in the House of Representatives or the U.S. Senate. And so they've been doing all of this for years and years and years. And to focus on only one aspect of it, we miss the bigger picture. We miss the ultimate goal. And I think to an extent that's kind of caught the Democrats off guard, because suddenly once all the pieces are in place, it's hard to attack it as a whole, and that's where we are right now, I believe.
You're right. The Democrats have depended on bipartisanship, and over the years, they've passed pro-labor with the Wagner Act. They passed McCain-Feingold, bipartisan campaign reform act. They passed the Voting Rights Act of 65. They passed the reauthorization of it completely in 2006. So the Democrats focus on trying to work with the other members of Congress and to get things through on a bipartisan basis. That obviously doesn't work anymore. The elite power purchase that's currently taking place has a small group of elite who are pushing exclusion of the minority. They're attacking and destroying American values, voting rights, labor rights, and campaign finance reform. And just like, for example, the Voting Rights Act, which was passed on a bipartisan basis, was just wiped out by what? By the Roberts Court, the wholly owned Roberts Court. So the wealthy are purchasing the powerful. They're getting conservative state legislatures, conservative governors, right-wing congressmen, and then they really had a scare in 2008 with the election of Obama on such a populist basis. They felt threatened. They had owned the White House for 8 years with Bush and Cheney, and so this was interesting. They fought back with an army of lobbyists. Now, if you go back and look at the lobbyists starting in 1971, there were 175 lobbyists registered in D.C. By 82, it got to 2,500. Now, their registered number in 2013 was 12,281, but a lot of lobbyists are operating under the same registration. The actual count of lobbyists in Washington right now is closer to 100,000. And so this is government by the lobbyists, of the lobbyists, by the lobbyists, for the corporations.
Well, and, again, it all goes back to when you look at the 1970s, this Powell memo by Lewis Powell, before he joined the Supreme Court, he laid out this plan for the Republican Party in order to achieve these goals. But it wasn't because Powell wanted necessarily, to help Republicans succeed. This was to help corporations succeed.
Absolutely.
And all of these things that have been done, it's not to the benefit of the Republican Party, other than they get more money from corporations. It's to benefit the already wealthy in this country. And so those people pouring in this money, they're not necessarily Republican or Democrat. They're just giving money to a politician willing to do their bidding, because we see plenty of Democrats taking this corporate money who make horrible votes as a result. And so, they watch which way the wind blows. Wherever they see they can make gains is where they will put that money. And most of the time, obviously, it is the Republican Party.
Well, it's not just mere chance that this happened. This was by design, and you put your finger right on it. Lewis Powell, who was a corporate lawyer in 1971, wrote a memorandum to a friend at the Chamber of Commerce, and he espoused the argument that the elites should assume more power, elites should have a greater voice in public decision making, and they should be making decisions all across the public structures, and all that more power than the average American. Now, Powell laid out a blueprint for accomplishing that, and they've been working under that blueprint ever since. Now, two direct results of Powell's memorandum. Number one, Nixon appointed him to the United States Supreme Court. Number two, the Heritage Foundation, which is flourishing today, was formed for the express purpose of implementing the Powell memorandum. To the Heritage Foundation's goal is to reduce power of the average American, increase the powers of the elite, and they're doing quite a good job of it.
And that all lands with where we are today, this attack on voting rights, the attack on unions, the attack on workers in general, on worker protections, on everything. And it all comes back to that 1971 Lewis Powell memo.
Yep.
And I don't think Powell could have ever dreamed that it would have not only taken hold, but be as prosperous for the Republican Party as it is today. And Howard, unfortunately, we are out of time, but thank you for telling us the story. It's something that most Americans don't understand, that this corporate takeover of America has been 45 years in the making, and really, they're just getting started.
And the bad news is they're extremely successful so far, and as you say, this is just the launch pad.
Howard, thank you very much.
My pleasure, Farron.
Are you ready?
The PAP attack.
A few years ago, conservative talkers dominated the media. About 90% of all the talkers on both radio and TV had a conservative slant. Thanks to social media, progressive websites, and free speech TV, and RT Network, an imbalance has shifted slightly. but conservatives are still the dominant voices on the air today. This dominance is mainly due to the fact that most conservative voters actually yearn for authoritarianism. They prefer to be told how to think and how to feel. Psychological studies abound about that detail, the inner workings of the conservative brain. And it almost always comes back that they need to be given their marching orders. They need to be told what to do because they aren't independent thinkers. That's why the media is oversaturated with conservative talkers. And that's also why it's so much fun to watch the conservative media tear itself apart during this election cycle. Rush Limbaugh, Glenn Beck, and the freaks over at Fox News have been pushing the Republican Party further and further to the right, and now their ugly personalities have personified themselves through none other than Donald Trump. And rather than trying to distance themselves and come across as the sane choice for the GOP, the other Republican presidential candidates are now having to jump on the Donald Trump conservative media craze train wagon in order to stay relevant. We saw this play itself out with Donald's insane proposal to essentially repeal the 14th Amendment and deny birthright citizenship to children of illegal immigrants that were born in the United States, by the way. Trump and his flying monkeys is trying to take America back to the Dred Scott days of history where former slaves and their children were denied citizenship for the sole purpose of preventing them from voting. Within hours of Trump's policy proposal, we saw other candidates, Scott Walker, Lindsey Graham, Ted Cruz, and Jeb Bush, try to out-crazy Trump's craziness on immigration. The reason this has happened is because the conservative media has been blaming immigrants for everything for years. They tell their viewers that Joe Sixpack lost his job because they gave it to illegal immigrants. They tell us we better carry a weapon at all times because an illegal immigrant's going to kill us if we aren't ready to shoot first. They stoke the conservative base's fear. They tell them who to blame. And then they tell them that Republicans are the only ones that can solve this imaginary problem. That's the key to conservative media success. But the burn down of conservative talk goes even further than anti-immigrant hate speech that we're hearing today. The lunatic fringe of the party, the fringe that conservative media created, is now pushing the media to be even crazier, to go further and further to the right. Donald Trump picked a fight with Fox News after the first debate, and he won. He got the network to back down by threatening not to come on again. The result was that the network apologized. Can you imagine? They apologized and they welcomed Trump back with open arms and sent Megyn Kelly on an unplanned vacation while they smoothed things over with the crazy Donald. This rightward shift of the media has taken an enormous toll on the Republican Party to the point that we have old guard Republicans out there talking about how dangerous the right-wing media has become and how it actually could end up costing the GOP this election because they're forcing fringe candidates on a moderate public, a public that's actually turned off by Trump's hatred of immigrants and his disdain for women. This really is the perfect example of Frankenstein's monster. The conservative media helped create a lunatic fringe, and now that fringe monster has started bossing the conservative media around. Meanwhile, we can all sit back and watch as the right-wing talking heads burn down their own party. Good riddance.
And that's all the time we have for today, but you can get more news, videos, and commentary at our website, theringoffire.com. And you can check out our YouTube page. Just go to youtube.com/goLeftTV. I'm Farron Cousins, and we'll see you tomorrow.